Bill Bank, and to those who are watching on video, hi. There's not much response there, is there? No. I do welcome you today, and I do hope you're having a good day and a good week. Today's service, the theme is gone. It was Carry Your Cross, and I'll explain a bit more about that during the service. For those who are visitors today, I do welcome you. Obviously, because of restrictions, there are certain differences. So for a start, everything now is up on the screen. So there's no liturgy to be held in your hands. And sadly, we are still not singing hymns. So the hymns that we have will be up on the screen. Please do join with them quietly. Down into your, yes. But I'll let you work that out for yourselves. I think that's all I need to say for this moment. So let's have a moment's quiet before we begin our worship. So we're going to begin with our opening prayer. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. And also with you. And we're going to have our first hymn. Please do remain seated. It is a Songs of Praise hymn, so the words will be up on the screen. And it's Morning Has Broken. Thanks, Paul. A time of confession, a time when we come to God with the things that maybe that we have thought or said or done that we know have been wrong and have been hurtful to others. And just before we have our prayer, let's take a moment to maybe bring these things to mind. During this prayer, there is a response. Hopefully, I don't know if red's the right colour. But it says, forgive me, Lord, and set me on your path at the end of each prayer. Let us pray. Lord, we acknowledge before you that often we can be like Peter, hearing your word but going off on our own, not wanting to see your path, especially if it looks rough. Forgive me, Lord, and set me on your path. Lord, we acknowledge before you that there are times when we want the world, but don't want to give much thought to our soul. Forgive me, Lord, and set me on your path. Lord, we acknowledge before you that there are times when we are stumbling, a stumbling block to others and to ourselves. Times when we look for complications instead of just following you. Forgive me, Lord, and set me on your path. And may the Lord God, who forgives all who truly confess their sins, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we're going to have our readings, and first I'm going to invite Ros to come forward and read from the letter to the Romans.
Romans chapter 12, verse 9, rules for Christian living. Be sincere in your love for others. Hate everything that is evil, and hold tight to everything that is good. Love each other as brothers and sisters, and honor others more than you do yourself. Never give up. Eagerly follow the Holy Spirit, and serve the Lord. Let your hope make you glad. Be patient in time of trouble, and never stop praying. Take care of God's needy people, and welcome strangers into your home. Ask God to bless everyone who mistreats you. Ask Him to bless them, and not to curse them. When others are happy, be happy with them. And when they are sad, be sad. Be friendly with everyone. Don't be proud and feel that you are smarter than others. Make friends with ordinary people. Don't mistreat someone who has mistreated you, but try to earn the respect of others. And do your best to live at peace with everyone. Dear friends, don't try to get even. Let God take revenge. In the scriptures, the Lord says, I am the one to take revenge and pay them back. The scriptures also say, if your enemies are hungry, give them something to eat. And if they are thirsty, give them something to drink. This will be the same as piling burning coals on their heads. Don't let evil defeat you, but defeat evil with good. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I'm going to invite Katie, she'd come and read our second reading, which is from Matthew's Gospel.
From then on, Jesus began telling his disciples what would happen to him. He said, I must go to Jerusalem. There the nation's leaders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law of Moses will make me suffer terribly. I will be killed, but 3 days later, I will rise to life. Peter took Jesus aside and told him to stop talking like that. He said, God would never let this happen to you, Lord. Jesus turned to Peter and said, Satan, get away from me. You're in my way because you think like everyone else and not like God. Then Jesus said to his disciples, if any of you want to be my followers, you must forget about yourself. You must take up your cross and follow me. If you want to save your life, you will destroy it. But if you give up your life for me, you will find it. What will you gain if you own the life, the whole world, but destroy yourself? What would you give to get back your soul? The Son of Man will soon come in the glory of his Father and with his angels to reward all people for what they have done. I promise you that some of those standing here will not die before they see the Son of Man coming with his kingdom. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let me just say a prayer. Lord God, in your Son, in our readings, told us to carry our cross and to follow him if we want to be his disciples. And in this moment, Lord, help us to reflect on what that means, both for ourselves, but for your church, and especially this congregation present here. And I pray this in your Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Is that cross recognizable? It's not quite the same. No, it's not quite the same, but the idea is the same. It's got a name. Anyone know what the name is of that cross? Okay, next slide. It's called a Gomez cross. And it's quite a sad story, actually, as to why we have this cross. Although it's also quite beautiful in a way as well. It's named after a lady in the next slide there, Maria Gomez. Now, Maria Gomez lived in the 1980s. She lived in El Salvador. She was a member of the Baptist Church, Emmanuel Baptist Church of San Salvador. She was also a national leader of a teachers' union. She lived at a time when, especially in Central America, many of the countries around there, it was one of those politically charged places. And so much was happening in terms of conflict, in terms of corruption, in terms of violence. And if you're on the wrong side of that, it could actually cost you your life. And sadly, Maria was on the wrong side of all that was going on. Why was she on the wrong side? Because she really cared for people who were in need. She was part of a group that opened a clinic in the late 1980s to help women who were victims of domestic violence. And in her spare time, she'd go to local villages and she would come alongside, especially the poor peasant mothers, and try to teach them how to read and how to write, because she was really passionate that they should be able to know their rights and to get their rights and to be able to stand up for themselves, to teach their children to do the same. And it was to improve the quality of their lives. It was to make their lives better. Because in those parts of El Salvador, life was really hard. And especially under the government, which could be quite tyrannical at times. And that was the problem. Because the people who were in authority, the people who were in charge, didn't really want so many people being able to read and write and to improve their lives, and therefore maybe even demand their rights and be taken seriously. And sadly, in places like El Salvador, they had a very brutal way of dealing with it. One day in April 1989, Maria was returning home from school, and some heavily armed men dressed in civilian clothes stopped the car, dragged her into the car. And sadly, a few hours later, she was found in a cemetery. And she had been killed. It was also noticed that before she was killed, she had been tortured as well. Now, over the next couple of days, thousands of ordinary people in El Salvador stopped work in protest at what had happened. They marched for justice. They held vigils in memory of Maria and in memory of all that she'd done for their people. And it was after she died that her church, Emmanuel Baptist Church, they commissioned a local artist. And they asked her to paint a wooden cross. And on this cross, they said, we want you to put something about the life of Maria on that cross. And so the artist went away, learnt about Maria's life, and produced this, which is now the Gomez Cross. And it reflects different aspects of Maria's life. In terms of the work she did as a teacher, in terms of the people that she helped in the villages, in terms of the cross that she makes in the God and the Jesus whom she believed in. And that is the Gomez Cross. It tells the story of this lady who, well, did amazing things, not just for the people of El Salvador, but the people of God as well. She did it for her Lord. She could have very easily just melted into the background. just stepped away from the things that she knew would bring her trouble. But instead, she, like many people in that part of the world at that time, said no, that we're going to stand up and do what's right to help these people get what they need in their lives. I did leave some crosses at the back, and I think a couple of the boys are doing that. And I just suggested maybe if you had a cross, what would you put in your cross? What would reflect your life and the things you've done, especially in relation to your faith and your belief in God? Next one, Paul. Jesus says in Matthew chapter 16, verse 24, take up your cross and follow me. He actually said, if you want to be my followers, if you want to be my follower, you must deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me. And nowadays, when we think about carrying a cross, we think of it as like a burden, don't we? It's a cross I've got to bear. Be it maybe something happened in your work life or in your family life or on your health. And people often use that term, don't they? It's a cross I've got to bear. I've got to carry, as if it's something that's bearing you down. But in Jesus' day, that phrase had a very, very different meaning. In Jesus' day, the cross, as you will know, was the most cruel form of execution that the Romans had devised. It was a very terrible, terrible way of being executed, to be crucified. And what made it worse, and maybe even add to the humiliation, was that those who were being crucified had to carry their cross to the place of crucifixion. And they would have to take their cross and they would take it to the place where they would then be executed. And so to carry your cross in Jesus' day was really to walk towards your death, because that's what it meant. Carrying your cross, taking it to the place where you will die. And so Jesus is saying, to be a follower, to be a disciple, you must be prepared to die. And for people like Maria Gomez, that is what it literally meant. She was prepared to die because she was doing what she knew was right, what God was asking her to do as a Christian, but also as a fellow human being. And still today, there are many Christian sisters and brothers all around the world who are in the same situation. They reckon nowadays more Christians die for their faith than at any other point in history. Something that seems a million miles away from us, doesn't it? In our church here, in our safety, in Hale and Hale Bank. Why is it the case that Jesus says we have to be prepared to die to be his follower, to be his disciple? I think for me, it's because of the conflicts we have in our world between love and power. The great Christian ethic, the most important thing Jesus said to his disciples, the thing that holds everything together, is love. Jesus said the most important thing is that you love God with everything you have, and you love your neighbor as you love yourself. And everything else, Jesus says, hangs on that. If you can love in that way, then everything else will fall in its place. And if the whole world could love in that way, of course, we would not have the world we live in now. But that stands against the ethic of our world. And the ethic of our world is very simple. It's power. And sadly, we see that all the time, don't we? On our televisions, in our news. It's all about power and control and having that power. And be that on a national level, be that in a local level, sometimes, sadly, even in church. Can be about power, having that power, that control, that wealth to be able to do those things. And very often love and power collide because they come from very different places. Love is always about freeing people. It's always about giving. It's always about the other person, always wanting the best for that person. Power is the opposite. It controls. It is about self. It's about making sure that I'm okay, even if it's that if it's at the expense of you. And that's what Maria came up against in El Salvador. And any Christian community, any Christian church, any Christian individual who truly acts out of that kind of love will always come into conflicts with those who are in power. And wherever that is, even here in Hale and Hale Bank. Why? Because love will always challenge the values and the beliefs of those in power. And Jesus knew this only too well. And it was in this conflict he was entering as he traveled toward Jerusalem. He knew exactly where he was going. He knew exactly what would happen. At some point he would carry his cross and he would die. So how do we carry our cross? We don't live in El Salvador in the mid to late 1980s. We don't face the same issues that maybe Maria Gomez faced. But what does carrying the cross mean to us here and now? Well, Jesus said in that reading that first we're to deny ourselves. And I suppose for me, that means turning away from the things that actually stop us from living this life of love. What are those things? What are the things that stop us from giving that love in such a sacrificial way? Is it attitudes? Is it beliefs? Is it actions? A lifestyle? A prejudice? Are there things that stop us from loving people in that way? Is there a point but no further to what we are willing to do and to give? Jesus says if there are, in our context, then we need to deny those things. We need to step away from those things. I was watching the news this morning and it was showing the images from the Mediterranean and the latest story about migrants coming over the Mediterranean, and of course many losing their lives, and ships like the one that Banksy is sponsoring are picking them up, and there's this demand to do something about this. And straight away I can feel the tension there between this need to love our neighbours and to do the best and to make sure nobody suffers. At the same time, there's a prejudice which says, but this is our country, they're coming into our land, they're taking our, and so on and so on. And I do feel at times Jesus is challenging me not to have any of those prejudices, to see somebody in need and to help. And for me, that typifies some of the ways in which I need to deny those things that might stop me from loving the way Jesus wants me to do. And we all have those things in our lives, actions, attitudes, beliefs, values, that in some way stop us from carrying that cross, from living that life. Jesus goes on to say that those who want to save their life will lose it. And those who lose their lives for him will save their lives. For me, saving my life, wanting to save my life, is not confronting injustice when I see it. It's not giving of myself unselfishly and sacrificially. In other words, it's when I don't show the love of Jesus that I'm saving my life. Why? Because I don't need to come into conflict. I don't need to ask those awkward questions. I can just get on with my life. But Jesus says, in a sense, you lose it. Because you're not in the place where Jesus is. And to lose our life for Jesus, to love in the way he loves, to give in the way he gives, Jesus says that's when you save your life. And I believe that's what happens, is when I know I'm in the place where Jesus wants me to be, needs me to be. But in the same way, I'm carrying a cross, because I'm doing away with all those things which would stop me from being the person Jesus needs me to be. But in doing so, may and often will bring me into conflict. So how do we do that? Again, it's not easy in our world, is it? Because everything's nice, everything's comfortable. We don't have to worry about those things here where we are. And it can be very hard, actually, to think in those terms, to think, actually, do I need to change? And I suppose that's where Paul's letter to the Romans comes in. And he gives us some very practical things that we can be thinking about. He gives an example of how we should live in Romans 9. And I'm just going to read some of those verses now, if I can find it. Love must be completely sincere. Hate what is evil. Hold on to what is good. Love one another warmly as Christians. Be eager to show respect. Work hard. Don't be lazy. Serve the Lord with a heart full of devotion. Share your belongings with those in need. Open your homes to strangers. Ask God to bless those who persecute you. Bless and not to curse. Be happy with those who are happy. Weep with those who weep. Have the same concern for everyone. Don't be proud. Accept humble duties. Don't think of yourselves as wise. Don't repay wrong for wrong. Try to do what everyone considers as good. He says at the end, don't let evil defeat you. Instead, conquer evil with good. And that's the challenge Paul gives us. But in doing all of those things, as I say, we will always come into conflict because it will challenge those in power. It will challenge those who make decisions. And Jesus challenges us then to still take that road, to still carry that cross. The chances are that being a Christian here in this country, in this parish, will not threaten our lives. We live in a very different society. But the danger is that we become too comfortable. We fail to see or respond to injustice. We don't speak up as it might disturb the peace. We must always be on our guard and daily carry our cross. As I said before, nowadays we see the cross as a burden we have to carry. I believe Jesus and Paul would want us to see it as it was originally intended, as an act of discipleship, continuing the work of Jesus in the world, challenging injustice, helping the poorest, helping the most needy. That will involve denying those things that stop us from doing this and may well bring us into conflicts. But that is the way of the cross. That's how we bring about God's kingdom here in Hale and Hale Bank and wherever we live. And that's how we bring God's kingdom into our world. Amen. Looking at the next screen now, hopefully. Oh, yeah. We're going to have the creed. Instead of saying the creed, we're going to listen to the creed. It's a song called The Creed, which is quite handy, which in music reflects some of our belief as the Christian community. So please, Paul, if you'd like to play. Creating one. stay here and look as if I knew exactly what I was doing. We're going to have our prayers. During these prayers, again, there's a line to read. It is in red again, and if it's the wrong color, do tell me. But the response is, merciful God, hear our prayer. So let us pray. Lord God, you reproached Peter because he had only human concerns. But Peter just wanted to protect the one he loved. We pray for people the world over who find themselves in difficult situations. We pray that they would have someone to care for them and lift them before you. And before we just say the response, again, just holding our thoughts in our minds, maybe people who we know, maybe situations that we've come across where people are finding themselves in very difficult situations. And we do pray that they will have someone to care for them and to lift them before you. Merciful God, hear our prayer. We pray for all who are persecuted for their faith. And again, we think of the many people for whom today will be a dangerous day because they want to worship our Lord. We pray for all who are misunderstood, for asylum seekers who flee real danger in their homeland. We pray for those who work tirelessly to address wrongs. Merciful God, hear our prayer. We pray for people whose lives don't always work out right, through their faults or through no fault of their own. And maybe take this time just to pray for those people we know who are struggling personally. Maybe friends of ours, maybe family members, maybe neighbors. Maybe we are the ones who need to come alongside and to care. Merciful God, hear our prayer. We pray for the people in our lives who need your protection, Lord, that we will always be faithful in prayer for them. We pray for those people who are especially on our hearts and minds at this time. And in a moment's quiet, we name these people to you, Lord, and we pray your protection to be upon them. Merciful God, hear our prayer. And we're going to say together the words of the Lord's Prayer. It's the contemporary version, or the modern version, even though it's been around for 30 or 40 years. We pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Bit of a flip back to the old one. We're going to sing again. It's up to you if you want to stand for this. I'm quite conscious you haven't stood at all in this service. And you might want to stand and sing along to In Christ Alone. You may want to stay seated. I'll leave that for you to decide. We're going to sing, have our second hymn, In Christ Alone. Again, the words will be up on the screen. Thank you, Paul.
Thank you.
as filmed at my last church. Okay, maybe not. We've come to the end of our service, and I do wish you a good day. There will be refreshments at the entrance, and again, please ask you to be waiting until you're ushered out. We're leaving through the door at the side, and there is a plate offering in the font or the box for the money that makes no noise to go in. What's so funny about that? I've got no notices to give at this moment, apart from one notice, just to remind those people that we had our final Bible course session last Wednesday, so there won't be one this Wednesday. And also to remind you, now it's coming to me, we have our annual meeting on the 13th of September. And again, if you haven't already, and you'd like to, or you'd like to nominate somebody else, there are nomination forms for PCC members and for Deanery Synod members, and even for church wardens as well. If you'd be fool enough to do that. Oh, sorry, Paul. Sorry. Forget I said that. as you leave the church. So it just leaves me now to say a closing prayer. Lord God, you knew what was going to happen to you. You didn't flinch or back away. You calmly told the disciples and us what to expect. As we go out now, remind us constantly to look to you in the good and the tough times, and guide us as we go in your name. Amen. So may the Lord bless you and watch over you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look kindly upon you and give you peace. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you and all whom you love now and always. Amen. Do go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.